So now we're ready to look at the common ion effect. We're seeing how the addition of another salt into the solution that has an ion in common with the salt you're interested in will affect the solubility of the salt. Okay, so let's look at this reaction here. Silver chloride is a solid, and we have the ions. And let me go ahead and write that reaction so I can be pointing to it and talking us through this reaction. So we've got the solid, we have the ions present. Okay, so we're going to come along, and we have this all in my little beaker. So let's draw our little beaker here, okay, in which I have a bunch of silver chloride sitting in the bottom, a little bit of it dissolving, okay, and it's set up its equilibrium, which I haven't really talked about, but every time one of these AGs dissolve, we know that one of the AGs is going to have to reform out of solution. That's what it means to be at this equilibrium. Then we're going to come along, and it says here we're going to dump some sodium chloride in there. Now, sodium chloride is a soluble salt. We're going to dump it in, and it's going to dissolve readily into this solution. And then we're going to have some sodium ions and some chloride ions. I wrote that very small. These are what are going to dissolve in there. Okay. So when you add that, and we think about Le Chatelier's principle, okay, which way will this equilibrium shift when you go and dump some of this into there? Well, hopefully you say that's going to shift it. Whoops, wrong button. Shift it to the left, so I hit my left button. Hopefully you said that it's going to shift it to the left. Adding, according to Le Chatelier's principle, one of these ions, you push it to the left. So we know what it's pushed towards. Now let's think about that in terms of the language we use for insoluble salts. If we're pushing this equilibrium to the left, would you say that the addition of the sodium chloride decreased the solubility or increased the solubility of silver chloride? Well, if you're pushing it to the left, it is going to decrease the solubility. And this is what common ions always do. Common ions, when you try to dissolve an insoluble salt into a solution that contains these ions, it will be less soluble. So it's an always statement. Now, will the sodium shift it to the left? No. It's not because there's ions in there and it's crowded, therefore it can't dissolve. There is an equilibrium between these guys, and when you add something to that equilibrium, it'll shift to try to get back to that same K value. So you're going to drag the silver ions with it as it precipitates back up. It's not a crowding issue. It's not the more ions you dump in, the less soluble it's going to be. It's got to be very specifically one of the ions in common. So if I were to go in there and dump some sodium bromide in there instead, that would have no effect on this equilibrium because none of those ions are in common with this guy. Okay, so we're going to work a problem here. We are going to work a problem with magnesium fluoride. So let me just give myself some space here and get that out of the picture a little bit of what's going on there. Now, when students see this problem, they think they should write a reaction between magnesium fluoride and sodium fluoride. You don't. You look for the insoluble salt and write its reaction. Okay, that's what you want to do first. So between magnesium fluoride and sodium fluoride, which one's the insoluble salt? Well, your solubility rules will tell you that, but in this problem, if you're given a KSP, guess what? You're given it for the insoluble salt, and that's the one you want to write it for. So we're going to write magnesium fluoride, solid, on the left, and the ions that make it up, which are magnesium 2 plus aqueous, plus 2 F minuses. Those are the ions in there. Okay, so there's the reaction. We give ourselves room for an ICE table. And we write the expression, KSP expression, equilibrium expression, law of mass action expression, magnesium 2 plus, and then F minus squared. Get yourself in the habit of writing that next. All right, now we're ready to fill in this table. We're going to dump some into here. But we're not dumping it just into water. What are we dumping it into? We're dumping it into a solution that's 0.1 molar sodium fluoride. And sodium fluoride is soluble, okay? It's going to break completely apart into these two ions and completely dissolve. And it tells me that I would have these two concentrations in there. So when I see that, I'm going to come down and say, I'm not putting it in with zero here. I'm putting it in with 0.10 here. Now, a lot of times students want to play this two in that. No, this reaction is taking place. That gave me 0.1. My starting point is 0.1 before this reaction ever takes place. It's only the change line that is this reaction taking place. So let's do the change line. I want to know the solubility. I don't know the solubility. I want to know how much dissolves. I want to know S. I carry this change across. I'm going to produce S here. And what am I going to produce here? 2S. So I had a bunch, a little bit dissolved, so I still have a bunch. I see a lot of textbook call it excess. Okay, excess is placed in, there's still some there. I have S and I have 2S. Then I have 0.1, sorry, 0.1 plus 2S. You take this plus the 2S. Now we're ready to come to our expression. KSP, I know, it's 6.9 times 10 to the minus 9, right? That's what it says up there. Magnesium is represented with S, and fluoride is 0.1 plus 2S, and that is squared. Now, we can make an assumption. If we don't do the assumption, we're going to have troubles, because we're going to have a cubic term. But let's think about our assumption. This is very small. You are not getting much formed. So what we are assuming is that 2S is much, much less than the 0.1 we're adding it to. If that's true, then we can ignore that term. And then it's just 6.9 times 10 to the minus 9 is equal to S times 0.1 squared, which is 0.01. So now I can easily solve for S, and S is equal to 6.9 times 10 to the minus 7. Okay? So that is the value that we would get for this. Now let's check our assumption. Even if we double this number, 6.9 times 10 to the minus 7, even if we double it, it's still going to be way less than 0.10. So that was a good assumption, and that is the solubility of that. Now before we leave this problem here, we said that adding a common ion of the sodium fluoride, or the sodium fluoride that we added, always decreases the solubility. So I'm going to take a different color here. I'm going to take pink. And let's just quickly work, what would be the solubility if it were being dissolved in water? Well, if it were being dissolved in water, instead of the 0.10, we would have had a zero here. And so this would have just been 2S. And so here we would have 6.9 times 10 to the minus 9 is equal to S times 2S squared. When you take this and you solve for S, you're going to get 1.2 times 10 to the minus 3. That, the pink, is the solubility in water. Did adding the sodium fluoride decrease the solubility? Well, sure, 10 to the minus 7 is much less soluble than 10 to the minus 3. And that will be always the case when you're dissolving a insoluble salt into a solution that contains a common ion. One more time, let me say, read the problem. Where students go astray is they see magnesium fluoride and sodium fluoride and they try to figure out what kind of reaction has those as the reactant. That is not what you do. You want to be able to write the equilibrium, and you do that for the insoluble salt. All right, we already checked that out, the solubility of magnesium fluoride in water. Okay, so we're going to work this problem next. Okay, so I'm looking at this problem, and I see that I'm trying to determine the molar solubility of silver chloride, and I've dissolved it in calcium chloride, and I've dissolved it in a solution that contains a lot of calcium chloride. So to me, by reading this problem, even if I forgot my solubility rules, I would know that calcium chloride, that's quite a bit to dissolve there, okay? So I want to choose the insoluble salt, and I want to write the reaction for it. Now, if this were a test question, it would have, right after all of that, that the KSP of AgCl is equal to, and I went and looked it up, it's 1.6 times 10 to the minus 10. So if that was given to you in your problem, then right quickly you know which one's insoluble. It's the one for which you're given a KSP value. So we write the reaction of silver chloride dissolving in water. This is a solubility product reaction, right? You write the solid on the left, the ions that make it up on the right, and we are not putting calcium chloride in there anyway, at all. We're writing ourselves an ICE table, and we are writing the KSP expression because we want to get in the habit of always writing that expression out. Okay? Now we're ready to start filling in the table. We're going to dump some, an excess. We'll do it this way this time. We're going to dump an excess of silver chloride into my flask. And when I dissolve it in there before it ever has a chance to dissolve, there isn't any silver. But there is some chloride, and we have to figure out how much chloride it has. I didn't give it to you directly on a silver platter. So we're going to have to do a little bit of work to figure out what's the concentration of chloride in here before this ever has a chance to dissolve. So let's see. We want to know the molarity of Cl- ions. In other words, the concentration of Cl-. That's how we would say it. From the calcium chloride. Well, that's moles per liter, so we have 10.0 grams of calcium chloride. The first thing I need to do is get that to moles. Okay, and so I go to a periodic table and I obtain the molar mass of calcium chloride, which is 110.98 grams per mole. And that's going to give me the number of moles of 0.0901 moles of calcium chloride. But I don't want to know the moles of calcium chloride per liter. I want to know the moles of chloride. So I need to take this one step further and say, I don't want moles of calcium chloride, right? I want moles of just chloride. And there are two chlorides in every one of those calcium chlorides. And so that is going to give me a value of 0.180 moles of Cl-. But I don't put moles in here, I put moles per liter, and there was 1 liter, so that is going to give me a concentration of 0.18. Okay, so now I know how much chloride. So that 2 subscript becomes a doubling of the concentration that goes in here. Now, we're ready to fill in our next line. Some of this dissolves. That is the molar solubility. I produce S here, and I produce an S here. That's going to give me still plenty, okay? An S and a 0.180 plus S. So I come down here and plug in what I know from my E line. My KSP is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 10, right? The silver was S. The chloride was 0.18 plus S. We can assume that S is much, much smaller than 0.18. Makes sense. It's a very small K value. And so I can ignore that term. I can take 1.6 times 10 to the minus 10. I can divide by 0.18. And that is going to give me the molar solubility, which is 8.9 times 10 to the minus 10. Check my assumption, is that much, much smaller than 0.1? Yeah, or 0.18? Yes, it is. So that's a good assumption. So this is the concentration of silver chloride that will dissolve into the solution. So what we're going to do next is we're going to see how pH affects the solubility. In this, we see that a common ion always decreases the solubility. And in the same way, not exactly the same way, but there can be an effect of pH on the solubility of the salt.